Hey, good morning, those of you that are watching by live streaming and those of you that are here or coming in the door. We are very glad that you are here with us this day to worship the Lord. And in our men's breakfast thing, I asked them, we were talking about cynicism. We were talking about how do you keep from being cynical. And one of the things I asked them, are you cynical about coming to church today, or do you have a spirit of expectation, or do you think, it's going to be another church service? And so, I hope you have an idea and a heart attitude that says, you know, God's got something for me here today, even if Dwane stinks. And after all, my last name is Pugh, so who knows what'll happen. But you will have an open heart. God will speak to you even in any situation. So I hope you have a spirit of expectation as we start this day. And I know normally this is something you do during announcements, but I'm going to do it right now. We're still trying to put together, make sure we got everybody, and we know we don't have everybody, but we're trying to emphasize this before we put it together. If you have not gotten into our base of information for our church directory, we would love for you to put your information on here. So we put together a church directory so you got a way to contact people. And if you so allow us to take a picture of you so that people can associate names with faces and makes it easier for us to greet everybody and make people feel at home when they come. So does anybody need this? This morning. There you go. All right. I will take that to my lovely niece. There you go, lovely niece. Anybody else? She can get it to you. All right. Hey, Carla. All right. Kevin will take it after that, and he'll get it over here to Chris. Please sign up, and because we want to try to put this thing together and at least have it by the first of the year. So plug into that if you would. Well, look at the prayer request list that we have. We've got some different ones. I've got Mary Lou Miller's funeral on Thursday. I'd appreciate your prayers for the funeral. Mary Lou talked with her on many occasions about her salvation. She knew the Lord. And just pray that God uses that to challenge the living through the departing of Mary Lou to a better land and better place. You can see the others that are there. I know there's several that may not be on there. I know there's different ones that have had flu bugs, COVID, those type things. I know there are people that are recovering from surgeries. I know Dal is looking at the potential of a second knee surgery on the other knee on the 13th of December. He's got something on Tuesday. He's got the last hump he's got to get over before they say, we're going to cut you open and put a new knee in there. So be in prayer for him. Also, this time of year is especially hard for those that have had disaster things happen. It's hard at any time, but when you begin to go into the holidays and you don't even have a house or whatever. So be in prayer for those dynamics if you would, and as families get together. You're going to hear this very much and very often from me, especially during this season. I challenge you to give a gift to the Lord of picking out one person that you've either never witnessed to or it's been a while since you talked to them about the Lord. Spend time praying about God preparing your heart and theirs, and seek God to open up the opportunity and be very intentional of witnessing to at least one person during this Christmas season. So I challenge you to do that. I've got somebody on my list that I've been doing it actually for about a month and a half. I've been targeting this individual, praying for them, and seeking the opportunity and the time to talk with them about their salvation. So I encourage you to do that. Any other prayer requests? This is a small thing, but not a small thing, and I don't even know that they'd want me to tell you, so I may be getting myself in trouble, but what's new? What's new? We've got two people in this church, Donna and Darlene, that are going to be meeting with two of the school board supervisors to talk to them about what it takes to be a school board supervisor, because they are praying about the potential of running for a seat So unless it's God's will, unless God's calling him to this, it would be something you just definitely don't want to mess with. But as I've said, if God's calling you to it, you better go and do, no matter what the challenges are. And we need good people in all positions of leadership. And so be praying for them as they're going to be talking with a couple of the school board members. Any other prayer requests that you mentioned? Tim?
Yeah, we have one from online. Jamie Blackman, her husband Andy has hurt his back, and he is very much in pain, cannot move. Okay. So she asked for prayers.
All right, they normally sit, I think, somewhere back over there if you're trying to put faces and things like that. So pray for Andy. He hurt his back. Also, John Dermody, he's not here today, but I know he had us praying for him with COVID or something. And so, like I said, a lot of different needs in prayer. Anything else before we pray? Yes?
Please keep praying for my sister. She's still in ICU. And then also my sister Lori, that does help with the Valentine banquet stuff. She has hurt her shoulder so badly that she needs surgery. And the surgery date is set for January the 5th. Okay. So she's the one that's been helping my mom so much, and because I'm so far away. And so it's just the enemy attacking.
Okay. Appreciate that. Any other prayer requests that you want to mention before we pray? All right, let's pray. Father, that very word, Abba, I am so glad, you know, Lord, we're studying these false religions and what we were talking today about, how every one of them says you can't know God. You can't have a personal relationship with God. I am so thankful that you are my Father. And though I will never know everything about you because you are infinite, I can know you. And so, Lord, thank you that you want a relationship with each of us. And you provided that way to deal with the sin problem through Jesus Christ. And so we come to you in his name, bringing our thoughts, our feelings, our desires, our choices before you, to ask you to bring them in line with your word, your heart, so that, Lord, we may not only be blessed, but we may manifest your glory in how these situations are dealt with. We pray for the sick. We thank you that we have authority in you, that if this sickness is just an attack from the enemy, we can rebuke it in Jesus' name and they will be healed. If it's about being chastened, Lord, they can get right with you, and Lord, you can reverse the chastening process of the difficulties. And Lord, you can give us grace if we're bearing a cross to show the difference that you make in a person's life, even as they're carrying something that is heavy to carry. Pray for that in relationships and families and homes, and we pray for unity and oneness around you all the time, but especially during the holidays. Draw us near to you and to one another. We pray for our country. Lord, I pray for the peace of Jerusalem. I know all that's going on in the Middle East, wars and rumors of wars, and Lord, it's just, once again, a sign of the times to look up for the fulfillment of Christmas, of you coming as the ruler, the Prince of Peace. And so, Lord, help us be busy about your business till that time comes, Lord. Give people wisdom. You know all the individual needs. You know our financial needs. Lord, help us to honor you in all things. Lord, be in this service this day, I pray. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to do Name That Tune in our tune quizzer. I said tune quizzer, and I'm sorry, I thought about Bugs Bunny and Roadrunner, the tunes, cartoons, and the Tune Squad. Anyway, so if you know this hymn, you know, raise your hand, blurt it out, and hopefully we will not be fooled. Guideth my soul. I think he hideth my soul. I think it's called A Wonderful Savior, though. He guideth my soul. Cleft of the rock. We know the verses and things. I think a wonderful Savior. Is that the title? He guideth my soul. Okay. He hideth my soul. Hideth God. All right, this is a good song. 258. 258. If you can stand. If you focused on whether you knew the song to sing it, I really don't care about that, but I hope you were listening to the words. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hands. You've heard me say this on a couple occasions. I've heard Kevin say that God's brought this back to his memory. I have around me a real force field. It is the force field of God's love. And I have a real enemy. There are demons right now that would love to do havoc in my life. But you know what? Anything they do cannot be done the way that they would want it done to my destruction, because it has to pass through the force field of God's love for me. If it's not going to be loving, God lets it bounce off and never happen. If God can use what Satan's doing to bring something loving into my life for good, good doesn't always mean easy, but it always means good. God may allow Satan to try to do something, but nothing of Satan's purposes have to be accomplished in your life. We have a blood covenant. I say many times as I'm dealing with Satan attacking me, Lord, I receive nothing from what Satan is trying to do in this situation. But if you want to use this situation for good in my life, I'll receive everything you want to do in this situation. And sometimes that means make me uncomfortable. Sometimes it means spank my butt because I'm out of line. It means a lot of things, but it always passes through his love. And that always encourages me that he hides me in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hands. What touches me has to go through God first, and so I'm very thankful for that. Anyway, we're going to take up an offering at this time, and I want to thank you, and very glad to see you back. How's the back? Better? Amen. We're praying for her back, and we're thankful for that. She had a bulging disc, and they were sick with stuff. But anyway, we ask God's blessings because... how many of you have heard in the news about a rail strike and potential not having this and that and the other and all types of jobs and stuff like that? Guess what? Heaven's not worried one bit. You say, yeah, but they're not living down here. Well, if your bank account and your riches are up there, what's happening down here won't affect that. Now, whether you got a slip to write a check on those riches, that's up to you whether you want to trust God for those things. If you're depending on the rail system, it may not be there. If you're depending on God's system to give us this day our daily bread, you'll have and you'll have to give away. And so honor God. Honor God. This is not because we need money. You need blessing. And that's not a prosperity gospel saying, you know, I want y'all to keep giving because it'll bless you. Blessing may not come at first in a financial form. It'll come in some form of God's favor and goodness to your life. But God will always take care of his children. God's no deadbeat dad. And so remember these things. That the offering is a spiritual act to keep your heart right. The world's going crazy during this time of year, especially about material possessions. Got to have them to be happy. Got to have the newest this, the upgraded that, the fastest this, the that. I don't know about you. Somebody asked me today while we were making men's breakfast, what do you want for Christmas? And I said, I don't want a thing. I did change that. I want ammunition. And you give me all the bullets you got. I'll take those. I'll stir those to save those up. I'll take that. But I really don't need anything. And yet this world, I think I mentioned it maybe a Sunday or two ago. I heard on secular radio, 80% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck, no matter what their income level is, and they are planning to spend more than they know how to pay for as the new year begins. If that isn't a crazy mentality of looking to things to satisfy, we don't have to worry about things. God will take care of us. So we're going to pray for the offering, and if somebody will come take that up, I'll do the announcement. So let's pray. Father, you have always been faithful, and you are so, so good. And Father, may we hear, not just give lip service that you're our provider, but are willing to walk by faith. I don't have to see it in my bank account. It doesn't have to be in my wallet. It has to be written in the book. And if it's written in the book that you'll supply and it is mine, then I can... It's money in the bank. It's there. I want to thank you for it. Lord, pray you'll guide us. We've tried to be faithful in 2022, and as we finish out this year and even think about the budget for the coming year, Lord, you always pay for what you command, and we want to be faithful. So give us wisdom, and may this truly be an act of worship. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So if somebody will take those up, we'll look at the bulletin. Where did I put my bulletin? Yes. You can say a quick thing because I'm still looking for my bulletin. Welcome. Thank you for that. And that was unsolicited, those of you watching my live stream. All right, if you look in your bulletins, I'll hit a couple of things. First of all, Open Gym. Open Gym is for the entire ages, all family. You can invite people that don't come to church. It'll be at the old high school gym. That's not the field house. That's there at the high school. You go in by the lobby and take a right. As you come to where the weight room is, go down the hall, you'll hear us down there bouncing balls and stuff. From 3 to 5:30, we'll be playing basketball, volleyball, and murder ball. I'll call it murder ball. Call it what it is. It's murder ball. And so we have a good time doing all those type things. And unless they've moved it, there will be a trampoline for kids to jump on and just all types of stuff to do. So that begins. This Sunday goes through the end of February except for December 18th. Excuse me, they're doing something there, so we can't be there that time. But other than that, it'll be every Sunday, even Christmas Sunday afternoon. So if somebody wants to come play some ball, you've done your Christmas stuff, and you want to go shoot some ball or whatever, we'll do it even on the 25th. All right. Deacons tonight, 6 p.m., notice that. It was in the bulletin 7, but y'all decided, rightfully so, I think, to switch it to 6, and we'll be finalizing some things. It is a closed meeting. Ladies, pancake dinner. Whoa! The 13th at 6 p.m., you're going to bring a $5 or less gift. Wear your ugly Christmas sweater. All right. And your PJs. Oh, or your PJs. All ladies invited. And hopefully you'll bring home any leftover pancakes because I'm sure you got Cameron to make them, didn't you? Yeah. All right. He's world famous in our world. Senior meal on the 14th at noon, which is a Wednesday. Y'all come on out. We're going to have a good time on that Wednesday at our meeting. And we'll do some Christmassy stuff also. Youth Christmas party, you can see December 17th. And the dynamics there. Christmas caroling. First of all, I need people who want to do it, and then we'll need a locations to do it. I've already had Sandy say she wants us to come sing to her, and I know some other people who have said, if y'all sing, will you come sing to me? So I just need singers. So if you're a singer, I don't care if you can sing on tune, we'll put you in the back. But anyway, if you're a singer, and we'll go out in our bus, we have a good time of fellowship. We'll even try to have some light refreshments when we come back, hot chocolate or something, fellowship. We're planning that on Friday night, the 23rd, if that works. And we'll give you more details about that. Christmas service, you can see. Thank you for the Operation Christmas Child. I know we have some special. We have a special today in Christmas music. So I know Daniel, I'm gonna put a plug in for Daniel. Daniel's going to be singing on the 18th, and his mom's going to be playing for him. Terry's going to be back. So we've got other, we got room for you to do special. So plug into that there. If you want a free gift that you can give away, so you don't have to keep it. You don't even have to read it. You can just give it to somebody. I've got books to give away. And we're currently trying to put together something. Some of y'all don't know this, but I did an audio version of this where I read this and Steve recorded it. And we're going to try to, if it'll work somehow, to put it on our church website. And you can literally download the book audio and you can print your own CDs if you want to listen to it, or iPods or whatever electronic stuff you want it on. So anyway... it's out there. If we can't get it on there, I'll let you know, but that's something we hope to do. So come get those if you want to. Any other announcements that I may have missed? Yes, ma'am.
The family that we've adopted, I plan to take Jen shopping hopefully Tuesday, Wednesday, the latest. So if you still have any donations, please get them in to Karen Monday. I'll be here Monday till about 11:30. If not, call me directly and I can meet you somewhere. If you're still planning on like grocery cards and things like that, they can go all the way up till Christmas. But for the shopping outing that I'm taking her on, it'll be Tuesday or Wednesday of this week.
Okay.
And thank you for all that have contributed so far. It's been amazing.
Anything else? All right, let's do some singing. Worship team, come on up.
Doing it. There we go. I can be helped. Good morning. I just, as I was getting ready this morning to come to worship, you know, some days, does anybody ever have a hard time? You still can't hear me? Okay. Does anybody ever have a hard time? You know, you want to worship and you just feel so heavy for whatever life circumstances. So I'm there. So I think everybody gets there, and I don't ever want to put on a mask. So if y'all, we need to encourage each other, and iron sharpens iron, so sharpen me. Lord, fill me with your spirit. I'm just going to start in prayer. Thank you, Father, for your grace and your mercy that's new every day. And Lord, as the hard things that we walk through, Lord, I never want to have a Hezekiah situation where you tell me something that I don't want to hear, that I don't like you told Hezekiah he was going to die, and then he was upset, he pleaded for his life, and you gave him 15 more years, but then, Lord, during that time, he fathered Manasseh, one of the most evil kings, and your best, Lord, I want your best. I don't want to just ask for prayer requests for my sisters or my mom. Lord, I want your best. And then, Father, for you to give just the strength and the perseverance to walk out what your best is, Lord, whatever it is, just help us all, because I know I am not the only one facing difficulties. That every single person in this room has something they're walking out that's hard. So, Lord, I just lift up this congregation to you in all the needs that we have. And in the needs that we're helping with others, Lord, other families. Fill us with your spirit, Father. Give us wisdom to know what you would have us to do. And, Father, help us to walk it out. And we want to bring worship to you now, Lord. in whatever heaviness we have with us, we worship you because you alone are worthy of praise. And you created us, Lord, to worship you, not in just song, but in the way we live our lives. And we want to thank you now, and I pray that your spirit would so flood this place, and not one person would leave this building untouched by your love and your presence. It's in Jesus' name that I pray this. Amen. Stand and praise with us.
Children, church workers, if you'll go to the back, and then young people, you follow out after them. And while they're going out, Darlene, if you'll come up, she's got a special for us. Did I knock that down? I probably knocked it down. Here, I'll hook it into a book. There we go. Got it hooked up there.
Yes.
It's on. Oh, sure. All right. My mic's on, Tim. We're good.
They're putting decorations up in front of my old church. The shepherds and the wise men and the hay. There's Joseph and his Mary looking down at heaven's birth. And the angels saying, don't you be afraid. Makes me stop and think about how you showed up down here in a humble bed made of nails and wood. Could have picked a palace, something more fit for a king. Then the story wouldn't be as good. Highest of the high to the lowest of the low. That stable tells a story of the distance you will go. For the lonely and the lost, there's no sinner too far gone to find a savior. In the manger, there's a star up in the sky that's calling all the least of these. Come and make your way to where your hope is found. And if I'm honest, some days I feel too far out of reach, but the manger reminds me love reached down. From the highest of the high to the lowest of the low, that stable tells a story of the distance you will go. For the lonely and the lost, there's no sinner too far gone to find a savior lying in a manger. You were carried by a manger, and just 33 years later, by a rugged cross made of nails and wood. And the tears fill up my eyes, you didn't have to give your life. Then the story wouldn't be as good. From the highest of the high to the lowest of the low, that stable tells a story of the distance you will go. For the lonely and the lost, there's no sinner too far gone to find a savior lying in the manger. Sing this part with me. Away in a manger, no crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus lay down. Sweet head, the stars in the sky look down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep.
I wasn't going to say this, but that confirmed that I'm supposed to say this. While we were singing O Little Town of Bethlehem, the last verse said, oh, come to us, you know, this day, child of Bethlehem, come into our hearts, I pray. And I thought, wow, Lord, I've never thought of it this way. You came to a crappy environment when you were born. And there are people's lives that are just full of crap, just full of poop. And you came and inhabited it and made that a holy place. And isn't that what God does at salvation? We acknowledge our need of Him. We invite Him into our hearts and lives. And even though there are issues that He's going to deal with and work with, because we've invited Him in to be born again in us, it becomes a holy place for all time and eternity. I never thought of it that way, and so that's pretty cool that He would come down that way. Turn, if you would, to Esther. And I'll review a couple of things while you're turning to the book of Esther. We're looking at the sovereignty of God, about seeing God in the circumstances. And so we've been looking at the book of Esther, and we'll continue to do so, to see God at work. Now, at the very beginning, we talked about God being sovereign, but God, in His sovereignty, has sovereignly chosen to work through the free will of men and angels. And we've been looking at how God weaves together everything. Everything you can see God at work in, the pieces of the puzzle. And as you begin to see Him in all the things that you experience in your life, even the environment, like we talked last week, that it all has a purpose to fit together for the picture of what God is up to. Somebody has said to me this week, said, I really don't know what God's up to. And I said, He's up to good. And if you look and see Him in the circumstances and things, you can sometimes have a sense of things moving forward. You see God's hands bringing pieces of the puzzle together. The picture may not be complete, but you're excited because you know the pieces are beginning to fit in place. So we're going to pick it back up at verse 7. If you know, King Ahasuerus is a king over Babylon, and he's brought all his leaders and his 100 and I forget how many providences. They've 6 months been reviewing the glory of his kingdom. He throws a big party for his leaders at the very end of it, a 7-day party, and we are going to pick it up there right after God had described the color of the environment. Which, once again, God had purpose in that in bringing up their pride. Verse 7, and they gave them drink in vessels of gold. And this wasn't Pepsi, by the way. The vessels being different one from another. That's pretty amazing, 170-something different glasses. Each one was a unique glass, unique goblet of gold or silver or whatever. And the royal wine in abundance, according to the state of the cream. King. And verse 8, and the drinking was according to the law, none did compel. In other words, you could drink if you wanted to, but you didn't have to. But you could if you wanted to, but you didn't have to. But they had individual cups and wine in abundance. God is sovereignly at work in the choices we make. They didn't have to drink, but I bet you every one of those guys were sloshing it down for 7 days. The wine of the king, the best alcohol in the world was flowing free. You just fill it up, fill it up, fill it up. So 7 days of this, I want you to imagine what their free. Now, they didn't have to. They didn't have to drink a drop. Give me water or give me, I don't know if they had tea. I wouldn't think so. But anyway, whatever they had, but they could have drunk something beside the wine, but I bet you they didn't. And I want you to know that your choices and the choices of people around you, God's at work in those choices. This is a bad choice. I'm going to guess, and once again, use your sanctified imagination. These guys have been drinking 7 days straight. Now, I won't ask if any of you have been on drunks like that, but anyway, if you have, you know what it's like drinking 7 days straight. So they're feeling really full of themselves. And that's an important part of what God is allowing to take place. Choices do not determine the heart, it reveals the heart. Let me say that again. That's worth y'all coming just to hear that. Choices do not determine the heart, it reveals the heart. And so God is trying to use their bad choice to show them some things in their heart that's going to come to their surface and dictate what they begin to choose. And we're going to see how that plays into the story as we get to Vashti and Esther and all that's about to transpire. But if they hadn't chose to drink, this story, I believe, would not have this particular thing. And so choices, good and bad around you, your choice is good and bad. Do you know you can't make a choice without God allowing you to make the choice? Now, God doesn't determine the why you do. Scripture says in Proverbs, I think it's 15:1, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and as rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wants to. God doesn't determine the water in the river, but he can direct where it flows to. Do you get what I'm saying? God is sovereign, but these people had evil in them, and God allowed their alcohol to take away their inhibitions and let this evil bubble up to the surface and how they're going to handle some circumstances that we're about to look at. But God was still at work in those situations. People around you have made bad decisions, and you've made bad decisions. Can I tell you, there's not a decision that you have made that God could not redeem and was in and fits in His plan if you put it in His hand. I told a student of mine in a Christian school years ago, model student, but she had made the mistake of her and her boyfriend having sex, and she became pregnant. And here this senior had to, it became known that she was pregnant. And of course, she let me know before she was showing. And I said to the girl, I said, I know you've done wrong. You've sinned. And there are going to be things that you have to face that you aren't going to like. But if you will take this bad decision and put it in God's hands, God will use you. You need to begin sharing with young women and men the mistake you made to encourage them not to make it, and how you made it, and what steps brought you to that, so that they may have some wisdom and soberness to not put yourself into some situations that make it easy to fall into temptation. There's not a decision that any of you have made that God cannot use if you'll put it in His hand. Some of you are haunted and weighed down in your relationship with Jesus Christ because you've blown it a lot in your choices. See God in the circumstances of your choice. A loving God wouldn't have allowed you to make that choice unless He could redeem it. You ever seen somebody with a kid, and at first when they're young you say, don't touch that stove, it's hot. And probably you've been in this situation. The kid's getting ready to touch the stove. They're older. They're three or so. They know better. And mamas are going to say, don't touch that stove. And probably daddy say, let them touch the stove. They'll learn. Just let them touch it one time. You won't have to keep saying this. Don't touch that stove. It's hot. Don't touch that stove. It's hot. Don't touch that stove. It's hot. Let him touch it one time. He'll get the message. And in the same way, God is able to show us areas in our life and choices to not only allow us to allow Him to fix those wrong things in us, but the very fact that we chose it and let God redeem it, God can use the most rotten of choices for the best ends, and see God in the sovereignty of Him at work in your choice options. Going on in the situation. So you got a picture that these guys are drinking 7 days. Verse 9. And Vashti, the queen, made a feast for the women in the royal house, which belonged to King Ahasuerus. And on the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine, he commanded. We'll get to that part in a minute. I want you to focus on verse 9. Men, I want to ask you a question. What do you think women talk about when they get together? I want to bet you big money they were talking about their sorry, no good husbands and what they didn't do or should have done or whatever. And I don't know that they drunk, because it didn't say about them, but if the king and the men are drinking, I'm going to guess royal wine was there potentially for the ladies. It doesn't say that, so I'm not going to guarantee. But I do know this. From observation of real life, when women get together, they have a tendency to talk about their husbands and those relationships. Can you imagine those royal women 7 days around each other, what the conversations were? Now, Scripture doesn't tell us, but I want you to know God was sovereign in those conversations. And I think as we move forward to this historical event, you'll see that God was in the fact that they were chewing up their husbands and talking about, because you got to remember, this wasn't as in our time. This is where a woman was just a little bit above a good camel, and depending on the good camel or horse, maybe a little bit lower. So women truly were second-class citizens. So they were oppressed and put down, and the idea of shut up and do whatever the men said, that was sort of the theme of how things went. So these women, 7 days with each other. And these are royal women. Royal. They're used to be treated with respect and whatever, but they realize we're just eye candy. We're not appreciated. We're not valued. So anyway, God works through the personalities of the people around us. So we're going to see this as we move forward. I wanted to point that out with the women's side. Now we're going to go to the men's side. Verse 10. On the seventh day, the heart of the king was merry with wine. I told you the Bible says they were feeling really good. And he commanded Mahuman, Biztha, Harbona, Bigtha, and Agbtha, and Zethar, and Carcass. And y'all are laughing because y'all are getting the point here that I'm going to make in God, seeing God in the circumstances. The seven chamberlains that served in the presence of King Ahasuerus to bring Vashti the queen before the king with a crown royal to show the people and the princes her beauty, for she was fair to look upon. The women are together for 7 days in whatever they talked about. The men are together. They're feeling good with the wine and everything like that. And the king, based on, I'm thinking Vashti either is very fat that they got seven guys to carry her, or she's very dangerous, she might get away. Why'd he send all those people to get her? Why not just say, hey, you go tell Vashti. He sent all these guys. Because he was showing his authority over them of, this type thing to bring to. And I can see the Vashti when they come, all of them come in and say, the king requests that you put on your royal crown and come before all the princes to show off your beauty. That's just like those men. That's all they think about is my looks. They don't appreciate me. They only think about one thing. And I'm not going to do it. Women, aren't we in agreement? We've been talking about this for... I'm not going to do it. I'm going to take a stand here. I ain't doing it. And the very fact that the king sent these seven guys to there and their personalities and their demeanor of how they came. God is sovereign over the personalities in it. If they were smart, they said, listen, Vashti, there's a bunch of drunk guys over there. And would you be nice enough to put on your royal crown? And the king requests your presence. Came across demanding. Women, how's it come across to you when your husband looks at you and says, I'm the boss and you will do? Didn't sit too well, did it? And then she's got all these other women around her waiting to see what she's going to do. And if that didn't egg her on to say, I ain't going. And you can't make me. Second thing I want you to see, God's sovereignty in your appearance. Listen, if she was butt ugly, this story would end right here. If she was just average good looking, you don't show off average good looking. Think of it this way. This is how I imagine it. These guys have been having a party for 7 days. There's royal entertainment. There's girls dancing and whatever. And they're probably talking about, wow, she's really. And the king says, well, you ought to see my wife. She's the best. I mean, I only am attracted to the best because I'm the man. And so, well, show us. Let's see. I've heard how beautiful she is. We want to enjoy this good-looking woman, too, to oogle her with our eyes. Women. How does that make you feel when you're just being oogled in eyes and stuff like that? And Vashti says, I'm beneath it. That's beneath me. I'm not going to do it. But she was very beautiful. I don't care how you look. If it's self-inflicted, if you've eaten too many Twinkies, that's on you. There's something God will tell you. But your general makeup as God genetically gave to you, you ought to embrace as a gift from God and see God in it. The problem is we don't believe that God knows what he's doing, and we always want to look like somebody else. Well, you say it's easy for her to be happy with who she is. She's gorgeous. Ladies, especially unmarried ladies, do you know that God has made, if you're supposed to be married, God has made a man that is going to be attracted to you for the uniqueness of how you look. So quit worrying. If you want to buy, I'll put in a plug for my daughter. If you want to buy Mary Kay makeup, you can. But don't be saying, oh, I'm ugly. God, why did you make me this way? I have a too big here and not enough there and too short here and too long there. Listen, if you can honor God and say, God, I want to take what you've given me and look nice to your glory, fine. But the way you're made. Now, let me talk to you guys. Listen, embrace who God made you to be. See God in it. There are dynamics in the way I am, that is God made, not my choice to not exercise or eat too much or whatever, or not. But see that God has created you the way you are and be at peace. This world is fighting a battle because people do not embrace who God created them to be. And we can't throw rocks at them and still have that same spirit in us that says, God, you made a mistake. I should have been this. I shouldn't have been that. I have too much acne on my face. I don't have enough acne. My nose too long. My nose hooks down a little bit. Have you noticed? Used to bother me a little bit, not much, but now I don't care. Plus, I got a good-looking woman. I ain't after one. Anyway, God, embrace and see God in the way he physically designed you. There's a purpose in it. You may not always see it, but God has got a purpose in it. Well, anyway, she's very fair to look upon. Verse 12, but Queen Vashti refused to come at the king's command by his chamberlains. Therefore, the king was very wroth, and his anger burned in him. Do you see God at work in human emotions? God works through human emotions. King was mad. He was fuming. She made him look bad, made him look bad in front of everybody, and then the very fact that she chose to defy him. Men, how do you like it when somebody under your authority defies you? Man, something that sets off. And God allowed a character flaw that this guy has. He allowed his emotions, because he's king. People are supposed to do what I say, to well up in him and says, this will not stand. I'm mad and we're going to do something about this. I don't know what it is, but we're going to do something about it. In your emotions, God may be showing you a flaw in you. I've heard this from people. I just got a temper and that's just the way I am. No, you may have a tendency to have a strong sense of right and wrong, and that affects you with anger. Do you know anger isn't sin if it's godly anger? But you probably blow up off the handle and allow Satan to hijack it, and your emotions are out of control. But God needs you to see that there's some adjustment that needs to be made. So it causes you or allows you to blow off steam all the time. And you just sort of justify it as, well, that's just the way I am. No, that's not the way you should be. That's the way Satan has got you trapped. But God is at work sovereignly. See God in that circumstance. Some of you are too emotional. And you allow something to happen, and you're all a basket case, and fear just gets on you, and you just, you worry, and you fret, and you plan of how to do, and God allows those emotions to happen. See God in allowing you to be out of control, so you realize there's something that needs to be adjusted in me. Whatever emotions, see God at work in the emotions. I'll do a good one. Whenever my wife or my daughter, we were watching TV last night. We were watching the Carolina-Clemson game until Carolina football does what it always does. I always say this, Carolina football never fails to disappoint me. No matter how close they are to victory, I say that, they're about to blow it, and they always do. Donna, in fact, accused me last night of cursing them. I said, no, I'm a Carolina boy, I don't curse them, but I just know their track record. But my point is, as we were there together, they expressed some love toward me. They said some very nice things. Jenny hugged me before she went to bed. Donna said some nice things to me. And that emotion, God was in that. God was in that. Because when they love me, I don't see them. I see God's love flowing through them for me. It was reaffirming God's love. Oh, if they're the source of love, then that'll change. There'll be something tomorrow where I won't, may not be so loved. But God's love doesn't change. And when God, they allow God to flow through their emotions to me, it reaffirms truths about God to my heart. So God's in the emotions. And see God in the emotions. Let me give you one more thing. I hadn't planned on saying this, but I want to add this. Do you know that's why the Bible said, train up a child in the way he should go? The word of training up in the way he should go is study your child in the bent that he has, like bending a tree. And do you know, sometimes when your child, you think their emotions are being defiant, they're really just scared. They're not trying to defy you, they're just afraid or whatever. And you need to understand that if God's allowing some emotional response from your child or your loved one or whatever to come to you, you need to say, God, what am I seeing here and what are you trying to do in me or in them? Let me plug into you in this so you can know what's going on in the heart of the people that are around you. And so, anyway, he was mad. Then the king said to the wise men, which knew the times, so was the king's manner toward all that knew law and judgment. And the next unto him was Kereshan, Sethar, Admathah, I can't pronounce where the who, Tarshish, Merez, Marsenaz, and Memucan, the seven princes of Persia and Media, which saw the king's face and which sat the first in the kingdom. Now, don't miss verse 13. They were the who's. They knew the times and the law. Wise men. They were considered the guys who knew it. Do you know there are rules that are over me that aren't necessarily biblical rules? I give you a case in point. I had to teach in a Christian school and they made me wear a tie. It was required for teachers to wear a tie. And I was using wearing a tie. I saw God in the circumstance because I hate ties. Do you know who invented ties? Women did, so it's a leash they can lead you around with if they need to grab it. I know what it's about. And then choke you if you don't listen. Tighten that thing. I hate ties. But I had to wear a tie every day to school. So we were talking, I was teaching a Bible class, and I was using this dynamic of the rule and seeing God in it. And this is what I said to them. I said, I want to ask you a question. If I teach the same lesson that I'm teaching now, with the same clothes and everything, except this tie is not on me, does that change the quality of what the lesson is? Does that change anything about the lesson? They said, no. I said, then why don't I go to the school and complain about how stupid their rule is and they need to get rid of this tie? It's not biblical that I have to wear a tie, so I'm going to demand my rights and I'm going to go to them and straighten them out. No. God, this is the rule these people have for whatever reason. I've chosen to teach here, so I'm not going to fuss and complain and gripe. I'm going to use this. I'm going to see you there in this situation as a tool to look at them and say, you know, your parents may have some rules over you that they can't prove 100% is thus saith the Lord. And you want to gripe and complain and fight against them. I said, you just need to accept them and be willing to function under them and you'd be happier. Your attitude would be better. I had a submissive attitude. So even in the rules over you, you need to understand God's dynamics. Now, I admit this somewhat with dynamic. How many of you are on a straight road and it's four lanes, two going in each way? I'm thinking about yesterday as I was going to Camp Red Arrow outside of Culpeper. The speed limit is 55 and at one place is 45. And it's on a Saturday and the trucks aren't coming in and out. And I thought about not following that speed line, that speed limit. But I said, all right, Lord, I don't want to have a rebellious attitude, and I'm not late. I've got the time to kill. I don't have any biblical reason. So I'm just going to go what they say the speed limit is, even though they say not to, even though I wouldn't have to. So see God in the rules that are over you and discern what God's doing with it, even to see if you have a rebellious attitude toward things or an attitude of submitting to what God would have you to do. All right, he asked these guys around him to do. He said, verse 15, and we're about ready to close, "What shall we do unto Queen Vashti according to the law, because she hath not performed the commandment of the king Ahasuerus by the chamberlains?" So the king was just asking, what should I do about Vashti? Now, the guy who's about to speak is gone off the reservation. Let me read you what he said. "And Memucan answered before the king and the princes, Vashti the queen hath not done the wrong to you only, but unto all the princes and to all the people that are in all the providences of King Ahasuerus. For this deed of the queen shall come abroad unto all the women, so that they shall despise their husbands in their eyes. And when it shall be reported, the king Ahasuerus commanded Vashti the queen to be brought in and before him, and she came not. Likewise shall all the ladies of Persia and Media saying to this day unto all the king's princes which have heard the deed of the queen, thus shall there arise too much contempt and wrath." Do you know what this Mamush said? Listen. See God in when people overreact. The king just asked, what should I do between Vashti and me? Because she's defied. Well, this guy said, she has done an insult to the entire empire. Every woman in the world is going to rebel. Every place is, it'll be chaos. We got to put a stamp on this rebellion of women in the empire. We got to show them who's boss. He was overreacting. But see God in that. He was wrong. God didn't make him overreact. As I said, God doesn't determine why you do something, but God can direct the fact that you have that tendency to do something to work in His plan. And so this person overreacted and came up with this plan that was completely bigger than the problem. When you're at work, do people overreact? When you're at school, especially teenagers, do people overreact? Well, so-and-so said this about her. And then all of a sudden, there's a war. There's a war. My friends, your friends, Facebook. Though I know y'all don't use Facebook because that's old people's place. And I'm not even there hardly. So I must be something else. But anyway, y'all are doing y'all's media. And it's a war. And it's like, over what? Let's be honest. It's been in this church. We've overreacted about the color of those doors in times past. See, God was in that. See God in the circumstances. See God to say, listen, y'all got to look past how many souls will be won, whether these are clear doors or early American doors. Look past. Why the overreaction? What is God showing us? What is He doing? What is He setting up? One of the things is this. When there's overreaction with you young people, don't listen to gossip. If you got a problem, follow biblical principles. Go to the source. Ask them face to face. If you can't settle it after praying about it and everything, take a good, godly, neutral party. I mean, there are ways that God says deal with things when there's problems and issues and overreactions. Most church splits are about overreactions to situations. Seeing problems where there really isn't that big. I love the phrase, tempest in a teacup. Do you know what that means? There's a storm in this little teacup. It's actually, there's little ripples in this teacup. But big deal, it's a teacup. It's not going to. And so many things get blown out of proportion. Are you somebody who has a tendency to blow things out of proportion? Women, Sometimes you can take things that men say, and we're dumb. We don't pay attention to what we're saying. And something will hit you wrong, and it just... Satan works that up in your emotions and in your mind, and all of a sudden you're overreacting to something. And so God is at work. And as we tie this thing up for today, the whole point we keep going over this again and again and again is so that you can begin living life plugging into what God is doing rather than what Satan is trying to get you to do. Because everything around you affects you. And if you're not seeing it from a biblical perspective, Satan can manipulate you. But if you're seeing everything from a biblical perspective, seeing God in it, and plugging into why in the world is this something that you have to face in this moment, no matter what it is, that's where you walk in victory. That's where you walk in authority. That's where you see God in the circumstances. And you become a powerful tool to cooperate and be used of God and to be an agent to display the glory of God. Everybody is going to glorify God, but everybody won't be aware of what God is doing. But when you surrender and submit to God, God shows up and magnifies himself in amazing ways, as we're going to see in the life of this little Jewish slave girl, what God does in her life because she sees God in the circumstances. If you don't know this, God is Savior. See God in the circumstances, bringing you to the point where you realize that you're a sinner and you're lost and you're on your way to hell. You need a Savior. And see God in the circumstances of the fact that we're celebrating Christmas. If you celebrate Christmas, you're acknowledging that God had to provide a salvation for your sinfulness. And you need to accept this Savior. You need to repent of your sins and trust Him. And we that claim to know Him, wow. So much of the fruit of the Spirit is just about seeing God in the circumstances. Let's pray. Lord, I am thankful that you are so, so good. And all my life you have been faithful. And if I take time to examine, I see your fingerprint everywhere. Everywhere. And so like we were talking in men's breakfast this morning, I'm not cynical. I know there's bad things happening in this world, but you're sovereign over them and you're at work. And so I have a spirit of expectation that you're going to use all this, which is so horrible and wrong and headed in the wrong direction, to work perfectly in your plan for good. So, Lord, let us have the confidence in you and open our eyes. With every head bowed, every eye closed, let God speak to your heart. And pray this prayer that God would open your eyes to see currently what He's doing in your life and why. The joy of my life is watching God at work and say it's well with my soul. Let's stand for dismissal. Father, thank you that we can know that peace and that joy that comes from our eyes on you, seeing you in everything. So, Lord, don't let this just be Sunday morning talk, but all of our life walk to have our spiritual eyes open to see you. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thanks for coming. God bless you.